We saw how to convert factorization into order finding last time, right? Factorization was a problem of factoring a composite number n, and we saw that we can instead solve this slightly different problem, which was called order finding, especially order finding over Zn star. If you wanted to factorize n, then we solved order finding over Zn star. That means given A, it should be co-prime to n, otherwise we'll already find a factor. So given A, need to find smallest r such that A to the power r is equal to 1. If we can find this order, then we can solve factorization. In today's class, we will see how to solve order. That's the objective for today's class. Let's start. The first thing is to realize that order finding is an HSP, hidden subgroup problem, over the group Z. Z is the group of all integers under addition. Just by the show of hands, how many people see that? Please raise your hands if you see that order finding is a hidden subgroup problem over the group of all integers. Okay. Okay. I see very few hands. Yeah. Let's see. It's not very hard. So one thing which you should know from group theory is that if a to the power r is equal to 1 mod n, I should say small n, then actually if I look at these numbers 1 a to the power r minus 1, they have all have different values, and then the value starts repeating. What does it mean? A to the power kr plus s is equal to a to the power s mod n. And ai is not equal to aj mod n if I and j are both less than r and I and j are not equal. Okay, let me just say, because I'm allowing zero, so let me say this. In other words, this value a to the power 2, a to the power 3, it keeps taking different values until I reach a to the power r, which is 1 again, and then the value repeats. So all these are different, then once again the same value as e to the power r is 1, e to the power r plus 1 is a, and so on. And this happens. So this should give me a function. What does it mean that I have a hidden subgroup problem over Z? I should find a hidden subgroup of Z such that there is a function which is constant on the cosets. So if I want to show that order finding is HSP over Z, I need two things. What is the hidden subgroup? And what is the function which is constant on the cosets of this hidden subgroup? By the way, what are the subgroups of Z? Sorry. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. What did you say?
Zn.
Zn. That is not correct.
Three Z.
Right. So what you want to say is
Nz.
Yes. 3Z. Nz. Where Nz is all multiples of N. Okay. Now, if I'm solving hidden subgroup, order finding, then what would be the hidden subgroup? It's the most natural guess.
The cyclic group of A.
The cyclic group of A is not a subgroup of Z.
Rz,
right. If A to the power R is equal to 1 mod N, then my hidden subgroup is going to be Rz and the function is going to be F of J is going to be which function? Is going to be constant on the cosets of this hidden subgroup. So, can you think of a function which is constant on, let's say, this subgroup? Any multiple of R, it gives the same value.
Mod n.
Sorry?
J mod by n.
J mod n.
J to the power R mod n.
J to the power. Is J to the power R mod n same for all multiples of R? So are you saying that R to the power R, R to the power 2R, all of them have the same value?
Sir, A to the power Z.
Very good. It has to be A to the power J mod n, right? Remember, that is why I drew this diagram. Right? If you think about it, what are the cosets of Rz? 0, R, 2, R. 1, R plus 1, 2, R plus 1, and so on. And we know that the value is same for these. This diagram is essentially drawn. We know that in each of these ellipses, if you want to call it ellipse, the value is same. So, and the exponents are precisely the cosets. 0, R, 2, R, 1 R plus 1, 2 R plus 1. So, it turns out that if I look at this function, Fj is equal to A to the power J mod n, it is going to be constant on cosets of Rz. Cosets of Rz are very, very simple. Cosets of Rz are all numbers which are same, congruent R, which have the same remainder when I divide. These are going to be the cosets. And because the order of A was R, all of them will take the same. With this specification, you should be able to convince yourself. I will leave it kind of as an exercise. It's not much of an exercise now. Convince yourself that order finding is an HSP. And I have given you the hidden subgroup. I have also given you the function. That means it should not be hard. You have to just make sure that the function is constant. I have given you all the things. You can. Okay. From now on, I will, even if you are slightly confused, don't worry about it. Work it out and you will be able to. But from now on, we will assume that order finding is an HSP over Z. This is what we need. Now, given that, what would be your approach? We want to solve a hidden subgroup problem over Z. we know that Z is abelian. Is it finite? It is not finite. So it is almost there. We know how to solve HSP over finite abelian groups. We know how to solve HSP over Zn, Zk or something, or Zl or something. But we don't know how to solve HSP over Z. Actually, if you had looked at the previous proof where I had shown that this function was a HSP over Z, you will see that if I had any Z k where k is a multiple of R, then again Rz would have been, not Rz, but Rzk would have been a subgroup. And then it would have been an HSP over Zk. You can try it out. But the point is, question is, do we know a multiple of R? Again, remember, we are solving order finding in Zn star. We are trying to factorize n, which became order finding in Zn star.
N, sir.
Sorry?
Sir, it would be phi of n, where phi is Euler-Totient function.
Very good. So some people might be confused and then say that, oh, R divides N. That is completely incorrect. Though R divides phi N, where phi N is the number of elements coprime to N. Or other way to say it, it is mod of Zn star. Right? Do we know phi N?
No.
Yeah. And that is in itself a problem, right? To find phi N, we kind of need to worry about the factorization of that. So, what is, so again, these are all saying that we are almost solving the problem. So, any guesses, what should we do?
Random choice, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Suppose random choice of what? Random choice of K.
K.
Right. But suppose K is very, very small. K is 2 or something. Right. And my R is big. Will that help? My period of the function will not even come inside this k equal to, there is no hope of recovering R. The intuition here is that even if we pick k to be sufficiently big, and again, this is something which I will hint at and not tell you exactly what do I mean by sufficiently big. There will be references where you can exactly figure out what sufficiently big is. If you pick k to be sufficiently big, then in zk, this function fj is equal to a to the j mod n is close to periodic. Okay. And then if we solve HSP over Zk, we might get R. That's the intuition. Okay. With this intuition, you will get a HSP-based algorithm for factoring. I will describe few steps of it. I will leave the details for you to read. But then I will describe another perspective of the algorithm, which is kind of different, but is more clearer. It is the phase estimation perspective. And we'll give some details of that. Okay. First, I guess, HSP over ZK, where K is sufficiently big. So in this case, I will choose K to be some power of K, which is between N square. This is what I mean by sufficiently big. If I solve HSP over this, my probabilities of getting the right thing, because my function is not completely periodic, completely it is not, there are boundary cases where it will fall off. So instead, I will take a big enough K and hope that my things work. They work, that is something which you can read in the reference. But suppose we choose such a Z. Now, so we are approximating solving HSP over Z to solving HSP over ZK, where K looks like this. Right? So what are the steps of HSP? Now you should remember, we have seen it so many times. Go ahead. What is the first step of HSP?
Equal supervision.
Supervision over what?
Group elements.
Which group elements?
ZK we are considering.
Right. So here we have ZK. So we create equal supervision over ZK. Then
apply the function.
Okay.
Query oracle.
Apply query oracle or the function oracle. So what state will I get? Sorry, it should be capital K. Right. So what will function oracle do? What should be the second register? A raised to power j. Who was this? So good. So this is pretty good. Yeah. Remember, we said that our hidden our function, which remains constant on the hidden subgroup, was a to the power j mod n. So that is what the function oracle will do. Then you will measure second register. And so I will just give some more intuition by picture. Suppose this is k. You have these, I should say, this is R, this is 2R, so on. And then last thing would be K minus K by R. Agreed? So this is not complete, right? The last interval that need not have length R, will be slightly smaller than R or whatever, smaller than R, because K, capital K, is not an exact multiple of R. And then when you measure the second resistor, if your value falls here, the state you will get is X naught plus so jr. If you are in this x naught coset, you will get x naught plus jr, where j ranges from 0 to
r minus 1.
How many times will you see? You will see x naught here, then you will see x naught plus r, then you will see x naught plus 2r. So how many blocks are there?
Box k by r.
Very good, right? So there are k by r boxes, and now it depends what is the position of x naught. If x naught was in the beginning, that means it has a presence in the last block also. Then I would get k by r minus 1 and 1 by square root normalization factor. If x naught was falling off in the last thing, its coset representative, its counterpart in the coset is falling off, it is after capital K, then I will get j equal to whatever is the normalization coefficient, x naught plus j. So I don't want to go into much detail, but what I'm trying to say is that this is the reason why we have to choose a big capital. If we had a multiple of r instead of capital K, if we had a multiple of r, then things would be way smoother. Everything will be nice when we take the inverse Fourier transform. Things will settle. Unfortunately, that is not the case. You see that it depends whether you fall in the first part, whether you measure whatever you measure in the second register. If it corresponds to some coset which starts from the beginning, then you will have k by r terms. If it is in the end of this block, then I will get only k by r minus 1. So because of these kind of issues, after you apply Fourier transform or inverse Fourier transform, your function, whatever you want to get, you will not get it with exact sharp peaks. You will get it approximately. And to make it more and more precise, you need to choose a big enough. That's the intuition. By the way, if you have read about Fourier transform, one of the things which Fourier transform does is that if it takes a peaked function, it converts it into periodic function. And if it takes a periodic function, then it converts it into peaked functions. This is the property of Fourier transform. And that's another reason why we are going to apply Fourier transform. Then when we apply Fourier transform, you can apply Fourier transform or inverse Fourier transform and measure, what you will get is that you will get integers close to multiples of k by r. If k by r was an integer, then you will get exact multiples of capital K. So you will get numbers like L K by R if R divided K. That was the lucky case, but that's not going to happen. If R does not divide K, then what we are going to get when we apply Fourier transform measure, we will get almost L capital K by R. So we will get integers close to L K by R. Remember that now L capital K by R is not an integer because K by R is not an integer. So this is the issue. But finally, we will get good approximations of L by R. This is same as in Simon's algorithm. We got L0, L1, remember, equal to 0, and so on. Similarly, in the hidden subgroup, we got characters which were trivial on the hidden subgroup. The same thing will come here. These are, in some sense, correspond to characters which are trivial on ZR. And that is why you will get approximations of L by R, and then using some classical post-processing, you can recover R. And this step is going to be the same in the phase estimation algorithm, so I will not describe it. But what I wanted to emphasize was that, and this is the way Shor actually wrote his algorithm in his paper. So what I'm saying is, whatever you have seen from HSP, that gives us how to solve factorization on a quantum computer. We get an HSP over Z, but over Z we can't solve HSP, so we solve HSP over Z to the K, where K is big enough. And then we go through all our steps of ZK. And then whatever information we get, it turns out to be sufficient to find the answer. That's one way to think of Shor's algorithm. Instead of applying HSP over Z, solve HSP over ZK, which we know. Just do all the steps as you would for solving HSP over ZK. The final answer you can use to compute the period or the order. This has been explained in Nielsen and Chuang. It is explained in Andrew Child's course notes, Wikipedia. So I will not go into more detail of this approach. The similar algorithm can be thought of with a different perspective, which is the phase estimation perspective, and that is what I'm going to describe. Any questions about whatever we have done till now? Okay. This was just to tell you one way to do Shor's algorithm. If it is not completely clear, read any of the references given in the notes and it will become more clear. Let's look at another way. I think that way is much more clear, which gives Shor's algorithm. This approach is by Alexey Kitaev. I don't want to say it is an approach. It's more of a perspective, different perspective to give similar algorithm. What is the idea? Remember, you want to solve order finding. Over Zn star, we will be given an A, which is co-prime to N. And we want to solve, find the order of A. This is the problem. Again, suppose there is a capital K, which is greater than n. So let's think of the algorithm at this point running in this space. So I want to define a unitary here in this space. define u such that u of b is equal to is this unitary clear? I want a unitary in this space. These are the basis elements. And I have written the definition like this. Have I described the complete unitary?
So what is bracket B here?
Bracket B, that is the basis states are written like 0, 1 up to the power k minus 1, right?
Okay, it is indexed by the group element. Okay.
It is indexed by the group element. So whenever B is element of Zn star, this is the action. So is this the complete description of a unitary?
Yes, sir.
Are you sure?
No.
See, because there are 2 to the power k
minus 1, 2 to the power k basis vectors, and we have just given on the elements of Zn star only.
Very good. So there are 2 to the power k minus 1 basis vectors, and I am describing it over just this many basis vectors. So clearly, it is not complete, right? But then I don't care what the unitary does on the other basis state. You can assume that u of b is equal to b when b is not in Zn star. Okay? So I only care about b's which are in Zn star. For other b's, whatever my unitary does, it is not going to matter. But now with these conditions 1 and 2, I have a complete description of a unitary. Right? Let's fix it like this. Let's fix our unitary to be this. If B is element of Zn star, then multiplies by A. Otherwise, it keeps the element unchanged. Right? That's a unitary that will take the orthonormal basis into orthonormal basis. This is clearly a unitary. Are you convinced?
Yes, sir.
Right? So no questions about this, right?
This is sir, what is A? What is A?
A is the element whose order we need to find, right?
Okay.
So we want to find order of A in Zn star. Remember, that was the problem.
Okay, okay.
So, okay, probably I didn't emphasize enough. I had described one way of solving order finding, which was the HSP approach. Now I'm giving the phase estimation approach to solving order finding. Okay. So again, remember, you want to solve order finding, you want to find order of A in Zn star. That's the objective. Okay. And for that, I have defined this unitary. And obviously, I have to define a unitary, right? Because I want to solve using phase estimation, so I should have unitaries, its eigenvectors. The first thing to convince yourself is that this is a unitary. And that I think is quite key. Okay. Questions? If you don't have questions, then I will ask questions. What is u to the power r?
Identity operator.
Very good. Does everyone see that? Again, raise of hands. How many people see that u to the power r is identity? Okay. Okay. 7. Okay. Okay. So for rest of the people, rest of the 10 people, please ask questions, but this should be clear from the definition. Because what is u to the power r? U to the power r on b would be a to the power rb mod n. Right? When b is element of Zn star. And u to the power rb will just be b. We'll keep taking it to b if b is not in Zn star. What is a to the power r? What is it? Right? So that means u to the power r is identity. If u to the power r is equal to identity, what does that tell about the eigenvalues of u?
Modulus 1. They all have modulus 1.
That is true for any unitary. Any unitary has eigenvalues whose absolute value is 1. But if u to the power r is equal to identity, then?
R is true for infinity.
Very good. Very good, right? So all the eigenvalues of u should be rth root of unity. They should look like e to the power 2 pi I by r multiplied by some s. That's okay. Where s ranges from 0, 1 up to r. So we know that all our eigenvalues will fall in this set. Okay. And actually, it turns out you can even find the eigenvectors. You can say that us, I define this as an eigenvector. So this is something which you can verify, that this is an eigenvector of u with eigenvalue e to the 2 pi I s pi I. Okay. When you will multiply u on this, you will see that it will fall out almost immediately. Is not difficult. Great. So we have a unitary u. We know that it has eigenvalues e to the power 2 pi I s by r with eigenvector us. Does that suggest an algorithm?
In phase estimation, we did this thing, right? Very good. Estimate the angle.
Right, exactly.
Argument.
So, if I use phase estimation on u, I will get good approximation of s by r. And from there, I get recover. Does that sound believable? That is what we did, right? Phase estimation actually gives good approximation of the phase. In this case, the eigenphase is s by r. So if I run phase estimation on u, I will get good approximation of s by r. I know probably no s, I can recover. Do you see any problem here? What does phase estimation require? I'm probably asking too much. I'm asking to remember what we did in phase estimation, but hope hoping few people will remember.
How to find the eigenvector?
Right. So Bayes distribution required two things. What were those? One was eigenvector, and the other was
the ability to do u to the r.
Yeah, apply controlled u to the power j or something. Right? Can we apply u to the power 2 to the power j? Remember, what was u? U was multiplication by a. Can you do this classically? Can you do classically? Can you multiply by a? Yes or no? Obviously, classically, we can multiply by a efficiently, right?
Yes.
Right. So obviously, we can multiply classically by a, and we can easily check whether a is element of Zn star or not. How will we check whether a is element of Zn star or b is element of Zn star or not?
GCD.
GCD, which is Euclid's algorithm. So it's easy to check if b is element of Zn star and then multiply by it. We can do all this classically, so we can obviously do it quantum. Remember, long back we talked about Toffoli gates and how to simulate classical circuits quantumly. Again, using all that apparatus, we can convert, we can apply this unitary even in quantum. Because we can do it classically, it is very efficient to change B to AB. When B is element of Zn star, we can do it even quantum. And even multiplying by a big power of A is easy using repeated square. So classically, we can apply u to the power 2 to the power j. That means we can even quantum leap. That is not a problem. The problem is eigenvector. Remember, US was this eigenvector. And not knowing R and in general, we have no way to prepare this eigenvector. That means no phase estimation on you. Okay, how do we draw it? So what to do? Need ideas now. We are stuck.
So, we will do it with any random vector and hope, like we did in, like we said in the last lecture, that after a few tries, I mean, we will get it with a mod alpha I square.
Very good. So, if you remember phase estimation, I had actually specifically included 2-3 lines there, which said that what happens if we do phase estimation on a superposition. Right? So instead of applying phase estimation on an eigenvector u, if I apply it on alpha n u1 plus alpha 2 u2, where u1 and u2 are eigenvectors, what will happen?
We'll get u1 with mod alpha 1 square probability.
Not u1, but eigenphase of u1.
Eigenphase
of u1 with probability alpha 1 square and so on. Right? So, not a random vector, but it turns out we have a very, very nice superposition. again some bit of calculation which you can do by yourself, it turns out that it is an equal superposition of US. The one vector is an equal superposition of US. And now you should be happy. So what will be the quantum algorithm? Actually, now the quantum algorithm is done. Do you want to tell me what will be the quantum algorithm? For order finding? You can look at the previous discussion. And then someone wants to take a guess of what the algorithm is now. It has to do with something with phase estimation, right? Any opinions? There is no harm in giving the wrong answer. Giving a wrong answer. Okay, let me help you out. We want to do phase estimation. But if I want to do phase estimation, I want to do it on a unitary with some eigenvector. So what unitary will I use and what eigenvector or combination of eigenvectors will I use? If you are awake, then raise your hands. Oh, wow. Okay, that's good to know. Okay, so there are people who have left. Okay, that's good. So there are people who are listening to me. That's very good. So then we want to apply phase estimation of some unitary. Which unitary should we use? Which unitary are we talking about?
We'll use the unitary which sends B to AB mod N, where B belongs to Zn star, and B to B if it does not.
Very good, right? So simple, AB mod N. So on this unitary, with what vector?
One.
With vector. And what will be the result? If I do this, what will I get? So this algorithm. So I just wanted to make sure that this algorithm pops out from our discussion. And if this is the algorithm, then what will we get? Will we get R? we are supposed to get R, but just by the definition of phase estimation, what will we get?
S by you.
For what S?
1.
For S equal to 1. That is not correct. Remember, if we run phase estimation of alpha 1, u1, alpha 2, u2, we get eigenphases of u1 with probability alpha 1 square, eigenphase of u2 with probability alpha 2 square. Knowing that 1 is this superposition, what will we get?
It can be any S.
Okay, you can be more concrete than that. If it is any S, then there is no way to recover, right? Yes, we will, the phases are S by R, so we will get S by R, but we also know more things. Look at this expression, why we were happy with this expression, right? So what does this expression tell you? What do we know? With what probability will we get some S by R?
1 by R.
Yes,
equal.
Right, very good, yeah. We will get S by R with equal probability for all S in 0, 1 up to R minus 1. This is what the previous discussion has told us. If you are not entirely clear about it, read notes, you will get clear about it. But for the remaining lecture, our task is to obtain R from this, which is again a classical problem. So I can now assume that we have this. We have S by R with equal probability for all S element of 0, 1 to the 0, 1 R. Using that, I want to obtain R. Right? R is the order. Our task was to find R. And if you remember, even in the HSP, we had a similar thing. This is what we got. We would have measured S by R. The peaks would have been at S by R. These are the characters. So these are the characters which are trivial on RZ. Characters of Z. Okay. So this is like what I'm saying is I'm talking about phase estimation, but this is like HSP. Everything is happening in accordance with HSP. This is like a sanity check. Everything is going. Now you have obtained this, you have S by R with equal probability for all S. Now we want to recover R classically. First, I would make an assumption. What is the assumption? S and R. And that would just happen because I will repeat this experiment multiple times, and at some point with high probability I should get an S such that S and R are co-prime. Do you agree with that? So how many
birthday paradox, right? That is
Sorry,
birthday paradox.
Birthday paradox, no. This is not birthday paradox. How many S are there which are co-prime to R?
phi of n, phi of r.
Phi of r, right? Phi of r. There are well-known estimates for a phi of r, which can prove that this number is high, but I will take a very, very basic approach. How many primes less than r? Do people know of prime number theorem? How many primes are less than r?
R over log r.
Approximately r over log r. Right. So then at least 1 by log r fraction of things are good. So I can just repeat it log r many times, which is not much. Right. And I will get s and r, which are good. Again, I'm using the fact that s by r comes with equal probability for all s. That's why if I repeat this thing multiple times, so repeat that, so let me just call this this thing, right? I will call this algo A. Okay, remember? And what is the result of algo A? We also remember. It will give us S by R with equal probability for all S. Now, if I repeat algo A multiple times, let's say order of n times, then with high probability, we get, it should not be n. We don't have n many times, log n. We get approximation to S by R, where S and R are co-prime. This is the first simplification. Does that sound okay? Any confusion in this? The step which I have done is I had S by R with equal probability for all S, knowing that there are a lot of co-prime S as compared to R. So I repeat this process multiple times, and with high probability, I will have an S by R where S and R are. A simple proof is just by looking at S's which are prime. So actually you can say that not just that we are S and R co-prime, where S is a prime.
So, sir, when we are getting the output S over R, So are we getting as rational number or their decimal expansion?
We are getting the binary expansion, which is close to S by R.
So how are we going to recover S over R?
This is a very, very good question, and that's the remaining thing which we're going to do. But you agree that I will get an approximation to S by R where S is a prime and R is an order, right?
Yes, sir.
Or S and R are co-prime, right?
Yes.
That we can assume. Okay, good. Now, if you know that, it's a very, very good question. Now our task is we are given. So I just want to keep simplifying the problem. Now, we are given approximation to S by R, where S and R are co-prime. Our task is to recover R. Whatever we have done till now should convince you that this is the part which is left. From phase estimation, from algo A, we get approximations to S by R with equal probability. If we repeat it then with high probability we will get an approximation to S by R, where S and R are. And when that happens, when we get an approximation to S by R, where S and R are co-prime, then immediately we can recover R using some unknown algorithm. So this, at this point, this is not. This is the remaining part. And this part is done by a beautiful piece of mathematics, which is called continued fractionality. This is something which has been known from before. This is a very nice piece, but using approximation to S by R, you can recover R, and this is done using continued fraction. I'm not going to tell you the algorithm, I'm just going to tell you the theorem which does that. The theorem says that let S and R be co-prime as given. Let phi be an approximation to S by R such that it is very close. Then, using phi, we can recover S and R in poly log R time. Okay, we have to understand this theorem first, and then some technicalities remain, but that should give you the intuition of how to recover R. So what does it say? Remember, we are given that we are getting an approximation to S by R. This theorem says that if we get a close enough approximation, if we have an approximation which satisfies this condition, if this precision is given to us, it is given that S by R and phi are not far apart, then using phi, we can recover S and R in poly. Now the first question as a mathematician would be, there can be multiple S by R's which are close to phi in this regime. Which S by R are we talking about? Is that question clear? There can be S1 by R1 and S2 by R2, both of them satisfying this condition. Then which one will theorem output? S1 by R1 or S2 by R2? Again, I want you to, do you understand the theorem? Can it happen that there are two S1 by R1 and S2 by R2, both of them are close to phi in this amount?
Yes, sir.
Can that happen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if there is no condition on R1 and R2, but if I tell you that R1, R2 are less than equal to R, then? If I know that R1 and R2 are less than equal to R, then what is the minimum possible distance between S1 by R1 and S2 by R2?
S1 minus S2 by R.
No. Right. So if S1 by R1 and S2 by R2 are two numbers, their difference would be. This is R2 S1 minus R1 S2 by R1 R2, right? And what do I know about R2 S1 minus R1 by R1 S2? It will be at least 1, right? It will be some integer, right? So this quantity will be greater than 1 by R1 R2, which is greater than 1 by
R square.
Right? But if both of the, these numbers, S1 by R1, S2 by R2, were close to phi within a distance of 1 by 2 R square, then their distance would be most one by R, right? So you see that here I will give the smallest number with the smallest denominator such that S by R minus phi is less than 1 by 2. This is what the theorem will do. Right? So this theorem makes sense. This is what I want to say. Okay. So we get an approximation to S by R using phase estimation, and continued fraction algorithm tells us that if we have this much precision on our algorithm, then we are done. Then we will actually recover not just R, but we will recover both S as well as R. So this theorem tells us that we should do phase estimation with precision 1 by 2 R square. If I do phase estimation with precision 1 by 2 R square, that means my approximation to S by R will be in this range. And then applying this continued fraction algorithm, I can recover S and R. Now, do I know R? Obviously not. That was the problem. So what can I do?
You can do it with precision of 1 by 2 n square.
Right, because R is less than. Right. And if you remember phase estimation, or if you don't remember phase estimation, you can check. That basically means that I will need approximately these many, which is fine, which is just a multiple of log. So that is still okay. Okay, so that is the, I should say, algorithm that you repeat phase estimation of U. I don't have to describe U. You have seen that. This is multiplication by A when B is element of the n star, on 1 multiple times. So this is the final algorithm in some sense. Shor's algorithm. Repeat phase estimation on 1 multiple times with actually there is some error also if you want to make sure that algorithms with some precision, some error, not precision, sorry, with some error, then there will be some small amount of qubits used for that also. If you look at phase estimation, you will see that this F epsilon factor comes. So with these many qubits, once you do that, you will get with high probability, we will get approximation to S by R, where GCD of S and R is one. They are covariant. If this is the case, then applying continued fraction, we get SNR. Applying continued fraction theorem. And R is the order. This finishes the algorithm using the phase estimation. I have even drawn the circuit for this. And if you look at that circuit and the circuit coming from HSP, you will realize that they are almost essentially the same. Algorithms are very, very similar. It's just the perspective which is different. I advise you to read the other HSP-based algorithm also from one of the references in the notes. Okay, so one other thing here which I haven't talked about is this continued fraction algorithm. Many people have asked me for a small project or something. So if you are interested, you can read about this and present it to the class. I can find a time in for the class where you can talk about it. This is completely classical and it's a very, very nice work. So I'm sure whoever reads it will be rewarded. If you are interested, please read this and then you can present it to the entire class as a site. Let me know if you want to do it. Send me.
Where can we find this thing?
Continued fraction algorithm. You can find it in Nielsen and Chuang, for example, and references there thereafter. In Wikipedia, there will be references. There will be multiple places where you can do this. It's a very nice book. So, yeah, you can take a look at the resources, and if you feel that you can talk about it to the class, please do. I would be very, very happy to arrange some time when you can present this. I'm not saying anything about the grade for this, but it will be a very, very rewarding experience, actually. It's up to you. So let me know if someone is interested. Okay. This ends the topic of the class today. Next time, Friday is off, but on Tuesday, we are going to have a guest lecture that will talk about quantum computing from physics perspective. I will send out an email also. I strongly urge everyone to attend it. This will not require anything advanced which we have seen in this course. And it will probably answer many of your questions which you might have about how these things are actually.
So it is this Friday, this Tuesday.
Yes, this is 3:40 to 4:55.
Sir, when do we have to present the continued fraction algorithm if we choose to do it?
Probably end of April.
Okay.
There is a lot of time. You have like a month for sure.
If many people opt for that, then what is the procedure?
So we will do a quantum coin toss. Prepare state 0, apply Hadamard, and then measure. No, I'm just joking. We can do a coin toss or whatever, right? So, by the way, how many people will be interested in such a thing to present things to people without having credits in the course? If there are a few people, you can raise your hand. Then I can put up two or three more things which are not in my domain. And okay, very nice. That's good to see this enthusiasm. So let me find a few more things. I can probably put them on the website. If you read something, if you are, especially if you are from physics, or electrical, or if you have some other take, some other topic which I have not covered and you would like to present it, please do. You can directly come to me. Otherwise, I will list out few of the topics and then we can have student presentations in the last. Definitely continued fractions algorithm could be one. It would be very nice to see someone talk about it. Okay. And then this Tuesday, we are going to have quantum computing from physics perspective. And from the week after, we are going to talk about Grover's algorithm. Again, in the first reading, I understand that Shor's algorithm might be hard to completely understand. But the good thing is that this is kind of a pause and reset button. And whatever you did before Midsem is good enough to understand things in Grover's algorithm. You don't have to, even if you didn't understand Fourier transform, even if you didn't understand Shor's algorithm, still you can understand Grover's algorithm. So from week after, we will once again start on a different direction and you can get that. Okay. But if you have questions about Shor's algorithm, phase estimation, please put them on the forum. And before I finish, any questions for whatever I've done?